Kaya Ginagay Yama. Hi everyone. Welcome to the State Library of New South Wales online programs and to another very special Talking Deadly. My name is Damien Webb. I'm a Palawa Melakari man from Tasmania and the manager of the Indigenous Engagement Branch. I'd like to start, as always, by acknowledging the country I'm broadcasting from, the Gadigal of the Eora, the traditional owners here, and also acknowledge the unceded sovereign lands that you're all joining us from today. I'll extend my deepest thanks and acknowledge the elders past and present and our generation of emerging leaders that are coming out strong as well. I'd also like to welcome any First Nations people who are here with us today. So today we're joined by First Nations Aboriginal artists and looking at the second part of the NAIDOC theme, which is always was, always will be. So the always will be, what does that actually mean? How do we think about the future? How do we work our magic realism and our futurism and our ancient traditions into the ways that we conceive of the present and possible futures? I'm very, very excited about this talk. So I am very, very happy to introduce Travis De Vries, our host for today. Are you there, Trav?
Hello.
Hi, welcome back. So I'm going to throw over to you and the panelists.
Damien, thank you so much. And thanks for having us. And thank you to the State Library. As Damien said, it is NAIDOC week. It's our week, which is damn good. I am Travis De Vries. I am a Gamilaroi man. I guess I'm best known for being a multidisciplinary artist and writer whose work straddles the line between magical realism and full magic fantasy. I use my artwork to present a world where various forms of First Nation magics and supernatural powers are real and interacting with everyday people in various ways. It's kind of like a mix between fairy stories or dreams where something dark is kind of just lurking outside the border of your awareness. I'm also one half of the comedy podcast Broriginals, which is an improvisation show that I do with my brother Texas, where we play Aboriginal self-help gurus with a direct connection to the dream time. And we get wuggles, which is the term that we've come up with for white people so as not to offend them. We get them to send questions into the shows and we teach them how to be better people. I'm joined today by some really incredible folks and we're going to have a great chat about this idea. So I came up with this idea a year or so ago to make a work called Fear of a Black Planet, which is a podcast I'm launching next week. And it's a speculative fiction piece where we follow the rise of the paramilitary Aboriginal group, the Warriors of New Dreaming, who are planning through various means, including the use of some Aboriginal mystical arts to reclaim sovereignty over so-called Australia, with all that entails. So I'll be interviewing various amazing blackfellas and exploring what sovereignty means, how we can enforce it, and what we'll do with all the white people once we're running the country again. But today, in sort of that spirit, I've got together John Bell, Claire Coleman, Brooke Scobie, who are in various ways Indigenous futurism and Indigenous speculative future fiction creatives and writers. Do you guys want to come into the film world?
Like magic.
John, we're just waiting on John. We might start with Claire. So Claire, you're a Noongar woman from WA. What I'm going to do is get you each to introduce yourselves in your own words, rather than have me read your bio, because I just think it's better that you tell the people who you are and not me put kind of words to you. So Claire, if you could please introduce yourself.
Certainly. Every time I do one of these things, I cough the first time I try and speak. I don't know why. My name's Claire G. Coleman. I'm a Wurlaman Noongar woman from the south coast of Western Australia. I write fiction and non-fiction, poetry and art criticism. I'm probably best known for my two speculative fiction novels, Terra Nullius and The Old Lie. And if I look tired, it's because I just finished my edits for my next novel recently. I think that'll do for me.
Awesome. Over to you, John. Can you tell the people who you are?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yep. I'm not great on Zoom. My name's John Bell. I'm mainly probably a filmmaker. Written a few TV stuff for ABC. Gods of Weed Street was something that I created and wrote all the episodes of. I've also written for Redfern Now and a few other shows. Did the first series of Black Comedy. And at the moment, I'm working on... we've just made a short film called The Mugai. And so we're working on the feature film script of that. And we're also doing a script about Pemoy, the warrior from Sydney. So a bunch of things, yep.
Awesome, thanks, John. I'm really excited about The Mugai because it looks scary as hell and I'm super, super pumped for it. Brooke, last but definitely not least, you're an emerging writer, self-described, but tell everyone a little bit about yourself.
So hi, I'm Brooke. I'm very intimidated. I like Travis said, like I'm an emerging writer. So I'm kind of like the baby on the panel. I guess more starting out. So I don't have any books or any cool stuff yet. I've got, a few essays and things like that. I like to write poetry. I also am really passionate about magic realism and creating worlds where, fantasy exists. In a way that's real. I'm a queer Bundjalung woman, so I like to include things that affect my life into the things that I write. I want to see myself in stories, and so and I want to create people and worlds where marginalized people can see themselves. So that's me.
Awesome. Thank you so much to everyone for coming on the panel. It's really exciting, and I kind of have fan moments for all of you in various ways. And
Travis, do it.
Brooke and I are actually working on the Fear of the Black Planet project. We recorded the first episode yesterday. So it's super exciting. And we might chat a little bit about that. I just wanted to kind of let people know how the session will work. We're going to go for about an hour. You people who are watching, you'll probably notice little Q&A buttons down at the bottom of Zoom. If you click that, you can ask questions at any time. After the hour, I'll be popping and monitoring the Q&A throughout. And if I see something super interesting in there, I'll shout it out and we'll might move to that. But I've got kind of five questions that we're going to go through. I don't know that we'll get to all of them because we've got some big brains here and we can probably muck around and talk for quite a while on various subjects. Claire, John and Brooke, I wanted to kind of preempt a few of these questions because it's something that I was struggling with how to frame them because I'm a self-proclaimed big nerd. But a lot of the cultural touchstones of futurism work is white work, I just personally would say. And so a lot of the questions are kind of framed is in comparing our work to those cultural touchstones in a way, and those narrative rules and literary rules. So if I say something that's framing something in a white way, I'm not apologizing for it, but that's how I've had to do it for this, this panel. So white people's futurism narratives often deal with a utopia gone wrong or a fascination with an apocalyptic moment that the protagonists have to then deal with. That's where the narrative kind of pulls and draws from. I've often seen the line kind of in chats and on the internet that as Indigenous peoples, we've been living in a post-apocalyptic world for generations. We've been experiencing that. So we don't need to envision a world where everything goes wrong because we're already living in it. I guess my like question is here, if we're already in the apocalypse, what in your opinion does our speculative fiction need to do? Are we here to present hope or a way out of our current situation? Like what is our job as writers or creators?
I don't really, I often say that I don't try and provide hope through my speculative fiction because I think that would be dishonest. And it's like, I don't try and provide happy endings for my characters because being an Aboriginal person, we haven't seen a happy ending yet. So why would I give my characters one? Why would I give my audience a happy ending when Aboriginal people haven't had one? What I try and do with my speculative fiction, rather than showing hope or a happy ending, I try and use it to show the truth, show it. I try and show the world we're in now using speculative fiction. And I guess in a way, what I also do is show how to fight. But I don't want to show the hope because I don't think the hope is there. I don't mind kind of showing people where to start fighting, but showing hope just, it feels really, really wrong to me.
I'm probably just, I don't really know how to quit something. Like, I don't actually know how to not fight. Like, even because I'd probably, if that were the case, then I'd probably give up and commit suicide or something. Like, I'm just a forward momentum kind of person. And that's a real family trait. And I think, I don't mean to, but usually within anything that I do, empowerment, even if it was like, you know, it's just a theme that I always return to, even when I'm not trying to go there. So it's always like, for me, it's always like I usually start with disempowered characters and just move towards them gaining power, but not through what society might deem as the appropriate ways. And that's not even an intention. It's just, I don't know, it just sort of comes out. You know, you inevitably, if you write enough, you find that you kind of write the same story over and over again. And I just end up there.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of...
Like, to answer that specifically, like in terms of futurisms, I don't think there's any rules, especially for us, that whatever makes us feel good, whatever is the story in the world we want to create as Aboriginal people, that's our right. And I think that sometimes those rules are put upon us from, you know, the white versions of this genre, of like, okay, this is how white people write futurisms. How can we be different to that? But I think like we can do whatever. So if like Claire said, we want to do things that don't create false hope, that aren't this imaginary thing, we can do that. I like the idea of creating a world where some of those bad things don't exist. Like I used an example before of like, you know, I really like Schitt's Creek. It's a fun show. And one of the things the writers said about that show is they created a world with no homophobia. It just wasn't even a discussion because there's so many stories like that where it's like, oh, there's homophobia and you're overcoming and da-da-da-da-da. Why not create a world where it doesn't exist? And for me, I would like to write, and some of my ideas and things that are in process are about creating worlds where those things don't exist or didn't exist or haven't existed without even discussing it, and just allowing for like Black joy, Black adventure, you know, and Black magic to come through in a story without all of the other sort of heaviness as well. So I think we can do whatever we want, as it should be.
I agree, and we should do whatever we want.
Yes.
And that's an artificial limitation that's been put on Black writers for the last 30 years, that we should only write biography or memoir or historical fiction or what I call suffering porn for the white folk. Yeah,
trauma porn.
we shouldn't have to write these things. We should be allowed to write whatever we want. And until Terra Nullius has inspired a whole bunch of Aboriginal people to write speculative fiction, because until that point, the young Aboriginal writers didn't know they could write speculative fiction to get it published. So I think that there's been artificial rules imposed on us from outside that we should absolutely not listen to.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's about that, like, we don't know what we can do until we do it, until someone else does it and pays the way. John, I think, like, one of the things you were kind of talking about there is, like, keep bashing your head against the wall until the wall breaks and you force through. Like, I think you were talking about, like, resilience almost.
And not even intentionally or anything, but I think also too, it's like you know you'll see a lot of, inadvertently it gives us stakes, it gives our character stakes. You see a lot of the times through you know, I'm going to generalize, but I'm just saying, like, sometimes, you know, a story about, you know, a couple in Newtown trying to deal with something that doesn't have any stakes. Like, it just, it does, it's not as interesting as people who actually are trying to overcome something. Mm. Stakes are everything in this story. Like, it's the lifeblood of tension or of just caring that characters will get from A to B. This kind of stuff that we're talking about, I think, it informs our ability to get protagonists that audiences and readers actually get emotionally invested in.
Yeah, I think with that thing with stakes as well, like, where racism and, like, the effects of colonization can kind of be, for white audiences, actually something that's hard to define, for, like, because they don't have this understanding of what that is. They have an idea of the concept, but without a lived experience of that, it's hard to define for a person. But, like, as I guess as Black fellows, like, it's a real fucking thing that we've experienced our whole lives, and so, like, it is the stake that's there, and so we can kind of write within that, and, like, the kind of overcoming that and creating something, creating a protagonist and a hero's journey that fits within those layers. It can be really interesting. All narratives kind of need a villain or an antagonist or a baddie. I would kind of, in recent years, there's been a lot of focus in the non-literary First Nations world on the idea of decolonization, and it's a buzzword and a catch call, so much so that some white dreaming people have tried to co-opt the word for their own monetary gain. Talk to me about your works. Are the villains in your worlds just metaphors for the colonial project? Is the baddie just colonization the whole time? Like, if I pull off their mask, Scooby-Doo style, was it colonization underneath?
All along, colonization.
Would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for those crazy Blacks. John, do you, yeah.
Sometimes just as an individual, like, even just as a black fella, just an individual, like, the villain might be another black fella trying to block you, just on an individual level. It's not, for me, it's probably not colonization as much as it's the impediment to the empowerment, whatever that might be.
Do you feel like that within your work, like, it's the driver is the human to human relationships and not that sort of bigger sort of structures of colonization?
Yeah, it probably is. I mean, it is to an extent, but those structures do still come into it. Like in The Gods of Wheat Street, which is a show that we did for ABC, the family were trying to become business owners, and even though that might not have been a, it doesn't sound inherently interesting, but it just was something that we hadn't seen before, like a black family, Aboriginal family, becoming a business owner and finding some semblance of power within this sort of, you know, economy. So sometimes it is that kind of stuff, but for me, mostly it's probably the human to human relationships. But there's also a notion that I'm getting older, I'm becoming more acquainted with, which is that some people just will never ever see your point of view.
What about you, Claire?
In my two novels, the baddies have definitely been colonization. You know, you pull off the mask and it is colonization. And one of them is more overtly colonization, the other one is more the villain is actually based on a real person. Taron Elias, the main baddie in that, is a character called the Devil, who was actually based on a real person, A.O. Neville, the protector of Aborigines in WA, until the 1930s. And he turns up as the villain in my novels, in Amble and Quay Molyneux's novels, and in Kim Scott's novels. And that's because all of us have had family directly affected by this man who was called the Devil, the Devil Man by Noongar people in WA. So that's an overt character, but he actually is a real person who was the government representative of colonization. And in my second novel, The Old Lie, the villain is actually just colonization itself. It's there's no individual villain. I intentionally wrote The Old Lie with no specific villain. It's just the system is the villain, which is kind of a bit of a postmodern idea of what a villain is, but it's just the world itself is the villain, but the world is a colonial world. So that's another way of doing it. And in my third novel, I've been editing, the villain, which will be out next year, the villain is actually, the villain is prejudice and hate and all those things. So I don't think you need a specific villain, but in all mine, it comes back to the villain being what Terry Pratchett said. I love Terry Pratchett. I'm a big Terry Pratchett nerd. He actually said that that evil is treating people as things, and that's kind of what my villains are. They're all situations in which people are dehumanized by other people, and that's what colonization really was. They dehumanized us, and they thought they could just take our land because we weren't people.
Like maybe. Colonization is the weapon, and it is it's the people that are the baddies the whole time. Yeah. Brooke, I mean, you're beginning this journey into making and writing, and what do you see as your future baddies? Do you see a focus on colonization and that as an idea?
I don't necessarily, because I think that so many people have already done it better than I could. And so I kind of want to purposefully not. I think that all stories and all bad guys are some form of oppression that people need to overcome. So if we're talking about futurism, apocalyptic stuff, I know it's kind of cheesy, but I love The Stand. I love it. My mum was a massive Stephen King fan when I was a kid. So I obviously moved into loving Stephen King, and that's coming out, the series is coming out soon, and so for me, I'm very excited about that. And that his dark man is the Devil, and so it's always there's an evil presence, there's a something, there's an oppression, there's a power in the world that you need to overcome. So in some of the things that I'm current ideas that I'm working through, I don't want it to be colonization or just that. There are things that as human beings and as people and as blackfellas that are important to us. And when those things are taken away, if we're talking about culturally and we're talking about land, so, issues, things that happen with land and overcoming how to protect that and how to maintain that. So it might not be that white people are coming and ruining the land. It might just be that the land is degrading because we're not doing our cultural obligations. We're not caring for it. And again, with magic realism, for me, there's like, I like the idea of curses. I like the idea of like anthropomorphic things. Like, think about Fern Gully. Like, I love Fern Gully. Fern Gully should have been a black story. It basically is a black story. We just need to redo it. So somebody redo it, please. But I really like those ideas of, it's not necessarily a person. It's just something that affects the things that are important to us as Aboriginal people, and that we need to fight that in a real way, if we're talking about magic, or in a metaphorical way.
On magic in writing, are you a soft magic system or a hard magic system writer?
I like both, because I like full on fantasy, young adult fiction, fantasy, like, you know, everybody's got magic, there's dragons and shit. Like, I love that stuff. But at the same time, I like the little baby magic realism, like what Melissa Lukashenko includes in some of her stuff, where it's just like the animals can talk to blackfellas and that's just normal. But that's the only little element that's thrown in there. So I like the whole spectrum of that. I just want there to always be a bit of magic in the worlds that I build, because I want there to be magic really in real life, even though my four-year-old already doesn't believe in fairies, which I'm mad about. If I write more stories that are real to her and have magic in them just a little bit, I think it's magic to have magic. So
I have this like dream project of making a full codex of blackfella magic systems, and creating like a Indigenous D&D campaign. It's something that I've like kicked around in various guises for years, and like started on and stopped and started on and stopped. Like, yeah. Moving on to like another side of narrative arcs, which I think is like particularly timely with NAIDOC week and other people's ways that they interact with NAIDOC week. And this might be like draw on works that you've already done, but also like talk about like your speculative vision for the future. Allies and self-proclaimed allies. In the black future, Claire, what are we doing with white allies?
I think we'll assimilate them. And that's only partially a joke. If you think about the fact that as blackfellas, our cultures are suited to this land. Our cultural ways are suited to this place. We've managed to not destroy it. You know, 60,000 years, we didn't destroy it. 232 years, whitefellas fucked it. If you think about it that way, our cultures are suited to this place. So my dream for the future is that white Australian culture will become more black. Now, for that to happen, that's a bit complicated, because let's face it, if there's a common phenomenon in our real world where if a white fella is given any access to Aboriginal culture, they immediately claim custodianship of it and try and exclude us from our own culture. Mm-hmm. If an Aboriginal person is taught something, they suddenly become the expert or the elder, and then we no longer exist in their version of that. We have to avoid that. But if we have true white allies who truly want to learn and not own it and be part of us, not above us, then I think the only way forward is to make white Australia more black.
What about you, Brooke?
Look, it's a hard question. And, you know, we talk a little bit about it in Fear of a Black Planet in a comedic way. And so I think that is a fun way to explore things. But like, if I speak about like my work, I think that like white allies concept is very performative. I'm getting really you know, I am involved in, like, you know, activism and social justice-y stuff, just in my life. I think as an Aboriginal person, that kind of just comes with the territory. And I am getting real jack of people being like, I'm an ally. I don't want any allies. I don't want allies. I want accomplices. If you are not an accomplice to taking down these systems that have put all of us in this position, not just Aboriginal people, capitalism sucks for everybody. So if you are not an accomplice with us in Indigenous sovereignty and tearing down those systems and working towards a better future, I'm not interested in your performative bullshit. And I don't want you in my stories. You're not going to be in my stories unless I write you as a bad guy. So, like, you know, if we go back to villains, like, I might write a story with some, you know, performative white allies doing exactly like what Claire said, like taking over, like creating these oppressions for themselves so then they can feel like a leader where their ego gets stroked. So, yeah, I'd like to see some ego death for everybody, and more people coming aboard as accomplices. And I don't know how that happens other than me getting cranky at everybody all of the time.
John, do you have a?
Yeah, I mean, I think just going off what Claire and Brooke both said, the notion of you know, this, the saying "White Australia has a black history," like, White Australia also has a black character to some extent already. Like, in terms of, I think it's about White Australia admitting on some level that, you know, this notion of the Australian abroad who is just very laid back and very and can do sort of, you know, is very capable and has a relaxed sense of humour and has a sort of, there's not a whole lot of hierarchy. That's all blackfella stuff. Yeah. Like the laid back sense of humour and under sort of understated, like, America fell in love with Mick Dundee, but so much of what that character is blackfellow character.
They didn't go from England. English people are not like that, so 100%.
Yeah, and they don't, and like, Australia doesn't really want to admit that.
Mm.
The ingenuity that anybody who lives in this country has to have, that stuff's very, very blackfellow too. Like, you don't, you know, without cattle and plants and everything they brought over, like, you don't just live in this country without being super inventive and sort of super connected and stuff. And I think that that's probably the difference between our worldview is about, well Western civilization's worldview seems to be about trying to find, drilling down and trying to find how things work in isolation, or what they do in and of themselves. What is this thing? And our worldview is about connection and how does this thing fit into the other things around it? And those two systems, those two perspectives kind of manifest themselves in governing principles as well. If Australia had like the isolation is what informs class. Like, people think that they can isolate themselves from other people and that they can be better because they can do this thing or they have knowledge of this thing, and knowledge doesn't have a price. You just go somewhere, go to uni and learn it, or you just do whatever. It doesn't, you don't have to live to a certain point before you get that knowledge. And knowledge is an understanding as well. Like, that's probably the other side of it. Like, oh, well, I know this thing, so therefore I can make money, so therefore I'm better. But that's all about the isolation of the individual rather than sort of our worldview, which is about how that person's connected to other people and systems and weather and land and all these sorts of things. So I don't know if people can be allies until they sort of come to some understanding of really big concepts. Mm-hmm. And until Australia on some level goes, yeah, we do have a black history and we do have black character. I mean, even the thing about the anthem, Australians don't really care about the anthem. They don't really care. Like, there's a second verse, nobody learned it, nobody gives a rat's ass, and they go, oh, well, you know, you should sing it. Why? You don't sing it. You didn't even sing it until the 80s. Nobody cared. But as soon as it gets changed to something that everybody loves, nobody will give us credit for that. They'll just go, oh, yeah, it was always, you know, like a Jimmy Barnes song or Working Class Man or something. Like, that's what people will say. Horses. Then,
please,
yeah, horses. It's going to be horses. Yeah, that's right.
And exactly.
And nobody will give us credit for making and forcing that change. And then Australia Day is the other thing. It's like, what's
when the idea and the meaning behind the idea is more important than what actually happens.
Exactly, exactly. And we're the only ones who are questioning that. And we don't get any credit for that either. So
most Australians don't even know what Australia Day commemorates.
Yep.
Was it the Minister for Education 18 months ago, I think it was, she said that Australia Day commemorates when Cook landed in Australia. And that's the Federal Minister for Education. I mean, we don't...
Yeah. I don't think we don't need to delve into that. It's too frustrating for this panel. Let's keep talking literary. Actually, I want to jump to a question from someone in the audience, Sian, I believe, who's a Gamilaroi on Noongar land, is asking if we think white accomplices can speak point of view in Black futurism. Talk to me about that, but also like whether we can write from the point of view of white accomplices. I'm gonna get that word at some point. Accomplices in our works. Like, there's been a lot of talk in various years about representation and who writes Black characters, which is damn important. Can we write white characters and white accomplices? And why should we and shouldn't we?
People expect us to act like that. They want us to act white. They want us to be white. They basically tried to breed us out to be white. So why the hell can't we write them? Like, the power dynamic is not there in terms of it's inappropriate for you to write white people, because we are not on the top of the power dynamic. And if I'm writing a white accomplice, I want to write like what I want a white accomplice to be like. That doesn't necessarily mean that exists. It might. I've got some good whites. My mum's a good white. I like her. So like, I I'm mixed. I can write that. And plus, don't tell Aboriginal people what to do.
I think the white people made a big mistake. They managed to default themselves as the default character in literature. Yeah. If they're the default, how can they say that we're not allowed to write the default?
Yeah.
That's just foolish. They made themselves the very definition of normal. And therefore, if you want to write the so-called everyman character, the character that could be anybody, the expectation is that character will be white. Therefore, how can we not write white people?
Mm.
And I think white people should write white accomplices in the decolonizing struggle and the Black futurism struggle, for the simple reason that white writers shouldn't write from the point of view of Indigenous people in the situation. If they want to write those stories about Black futurism, the only thing they can write is from a white ally or accomplice point of view. Mm-hmm. So, yes, they should do so. And I think people should, for the most part, write their own point of view anyway, because they always are. Nobody is ever really writing from someone else's point of view because they're writing because they are doing the writing. You can only do a facsimile of someone else's point of view, not the real thing. So, if you want to be authentic, you've got to write yourself. So therefore, if white people want to write about the struggle, write about Black futurism, they should write it as a white person writing Black futurism, not try and be us.
Mm.
What about you, John?
It's kind of the same thing as like Australian actors can do a good American accent because we hear it all the time. They can't really do, American actors can't really do a good Australian accent because they don't hear it that much. So in practice, it's kind of like... we're surrounded by them, so we're probably more familiar with their point of view than them being surrounded by us. So it's we're probably closer than they are.
And even if they are surrounded by us, that's not permission.
That doesn't mean they can.
And the majority of Aboriginal people are of mixed race anyway. That's a sad but true fact.
I'm in the podcast Brooke and I are doing, I'm actually playing a what we would, some people would refer to as a coconut. And I'm really struggling with it because I like...
It's fun for me. I get to get cranky at him. So
it's to rip into me. I just have to kind of like, it's going to be fun.
Can I interrupt for, I've been trying for years to get a certain phrase in the vernacular, the opposite of coconut, Vegemite sandwich.
We'll make it happen.
That's good.
I've been trying for years to get other people to use that.
I think I look like a Vegemite sandwich.
I won't move on. This is a kind of different, a different track on kind of who we write for and who our work is for. And like, while this thing isn't necessarily Indigenous futurism, in 2018, Black Panther came out and was like, boom, it was like a global fuck yeah moment. And like, I was spinning out and celebrating. But like in 2016, Clever Man was on the ABC. The world is there with Black work and Black superheroes and Indigenous superheroes. But like, where do you want your work to be on that global stage? Is your work for the global population, or is your work for the Black community? Is your work for the Indigenous community? When I was thinking about this, I was thinking about that idea of writing trauma porn and like who that is for.
My work is predominantly for the non-Indigenous audience. And the reason is because what I have to say, we already know it.
Yeah.
So I don't got to teach other Black fellas what colonization is. And for three novels, I've really been writing about racism and colonization. And I don't have to teach you guys. I've got to teach the Wadjalas. So therefore, they're my main market because they're the people who have a lot of learning to do. My Terra Nullius is published in the USA and it's done okay there. And it's mysteriously made it into university courses in Germany and I think it's Germany and Serbia, I think.
Cool.
Weirdly. I'm sure there's a market for writing for Aboriginal people. There is certainly things worth writing for us, but I haven't really done it because what I'm about is about revealing the truth, the hidden truths of Australia, and we don't need to learn those.
Yeah, I think, I guess, like, for me, and if I can talk about my work a little bit, like, the work that I do that is for the Blackfella audience, I kind of think of it as my like manifesto or like my building blocks for getting to the future that I want. Whereas when I'm making work that I think is for a wide audience, it is a very different side of that. And it's about pointing out some truths and kind of punching them in the gut. What about you, John?
My work is probably is for Blackfellas, but I think my style tends to be a bit mainstream anyway. Like the ideas are very more about the kind of stuff that concerns me as a Blackfella, but the way the style tends to be mainstream, and so then it probably tends to cross over without that being my, I don't care if it does or if it doesn't. Like, I'm just really talking to Blackfellas probably. It's just more like the different thing in Black comedy, when we were doing the Black Force sketches, I was just trying to find a way, because we all do police each other so much and say, come on, what are you doing? That's not right. And then that person turned around saying, you know, mind your own business. Don't tell me how to be a Blackfella.
Yeah, it's not always helpful.
Yeah. So there's that back and forth. And to find the form for that, that is about just us talking about how we police each other, but the form is a sketch comedy form. And that okay. could be funny.
Is this your ideal audience? Would you prefer to write for a black fella audience, or would you prefer to write for a white fella audience?
Oh, probably black.
If you don't want to.
Probably black. No, no, probably black. I do write for a black fella audience. But when, like, so I worked on Cleverman as well, and when we went over to a couple of trips to LA, I was surprised in some of the rooms by how much people, how much it had crossed over, how many sort of, you know, talking, sitting there talking to Americans and they knew Cleverman, and it just seemed weird. So I think maybe the world's more interested in different people's stories too.
Yeah, I mean, I guess those audiences don't have to be mutually exclusive. I feel like, you know, we don't have to put those audiences into boxes of white and black. And Brooke, what about you? Like, who do you want your work to be for?
In a similar way to what you literally just said. So I'm more than just Aboriginal. I'm also like a woman. I'm also queer. I'm also mixed. You know, I'm also a single mom. I've also been a teenage girl. I've also, like, there's lots of things that I am and have been and will be. And so the stories that I write are not just for, like, you know, one particular one that I want to work on. I can't really talk about because it's all just ideas and stuff. It is for young Aboriginal girls, and I want them to want to read it and want to read, and I want to believe in magic and want to write and whatever, because that's what I happened to me when I read things like that. But I want to create characters, and I will create characters, and I will create stories that don't compartmentalize Aboriginality into just Aboriginality, because all of us are so many different things in the world. And I think that sometimes we get put into a, this is a black story, and then, but what about all the rest of it? Like, I want to write, like, you know, cute teenage queer love stories, like with adventure and fun, nice stuff that also are Aboriginal. So I think that, like, the audience will be, for me, will be everyone, but I particularly care most about what Aboriginal people think about my work, and I care most about how it positively affects Aboriginal young people and adults.
One of the ways I do something similar is in The Old Lie, I wrote basically a space opera, lasers and laser guns and spaceships novel, but I defaulted Aboriginal characters.
Yeah.
Unless I said otherwise, the character was Aboriginal.
Mm.
And people would notice, but I just simply wrote it as Aboriginal characters without even saying it. And the only time a character's race is mentioned, I kind of mock the white girl. Just like it, when you read a novel, they'll mention the only black skinned person.
Yeah.
This the only white skinned person is mentioned in my second novel.
Yeah, flip it on its head. I love that.
I mean, like, fantasy has a pretty bad rap for being non-representational, but then, like, one of the, like, big names in fantasy, Ursula Le Guin, her first character was a black character, but the publishers turned him white. Sparhawk, he was written as a black character, and then it was only the art, it was never specifically mentioned that he was a black character, but in Ursula's, like, later interviews, he was, but the publishers got an artist to paint him as a white character. I mean, I'm a visual artist. How, and other people who we're potentially going to do a panel with at some and another point are all Indigenous visual artists who work in spec fiction. How important is visual arts and illustrations to your work in various ways?
Well, visual arts have never been an important part of my fiction work, except that I'm always really bossy about what I want my covers to look like. Really, really bossy. But I'm also a visual arts critic as my other hat. And I think in that kind of gives an understanding that without people who say don't judge a book by a cover don't know anything about books or book marketing.
It's literally how I pick books.
That's how everyone picks books. So I think it's important to be so the look of something is extremely important. And you know, this, for example, this cover here, The Old Lie, I had 1,000 arguments about which order the three women of freedom of skin color should be on the cover.
Right.
And I, that was the order I said. There had to be the darker, the whiter, and then the more mixed race. That was very specific. So I think acting like things like that, like representation in book covers, isn't important. Is anyone who thinks that isn't paying attention to how the world actually works.
Yeah, I mean, John, you're predominantly a filmmaker. Like, so you, I guess you work in the visual kind of medium when you're thinking about the visual medium when you're writing and making at all times. Like,
it's hugely important. Like, certainly I storyboard as much as I can. But just sort of having concept, there's only so much you can illustrate with the written word, especially depending on who's reading it, and they're going, oh, so is, you know, and they're getting all sorts of misconceptions in their head. And as soon as you can put something, as soon as you can give them an image, it just helps people get the gist of it so much quicker. And because you're talking, depending on budgets, you're talking about millions of dollars, sometimes it's not just a necessity, but it's almost like, it's a secret, it's your main tool sometimes. You've written this whole script and you go, look, it's all in there, the story, read it. And people go, yeah, but I don't get it. Is this? No. And then you show them a picture and they go, oh, okay, all right, here's a check. What?
When you're working on a script, do you, like, are you already casting? Are you thinking about who you're
playing
characters? Like with Mugai, there was Maine and
Shari. Maine and Shari, yeah, absolutely. Also down to, I don't know if you've seen the poster, but the little girl is my granddaughter, and I always knew that she would be good for that because she's a drama queen, but also because she just had that kind of look. So even, you know, as I was writing, going back and forwards, I'll work with images of those guys on my desktop just to keep seeing them and trying to find the voice for them.
Cool. Brooke, are you inspired by visual arts with your work?
Not necessarily, but I think, like, I really agree with, like, what John was saying in terms of it allows you to control the narrative. Because if we're, like Claire was saying, like, the only person whose race is mentioned is a white person, if a white person reads that, are they necessarily going to know that we're talking about blackfellas or whatever? People's imagination is based on their default. So, like, if you don't tell them, and you don't want to tell them because it's sloppy writing or whatever, or it's cheating, or you just want it to be that way. You want to challenge people's way of thinking and their way of their imagination. Like, if every character you see in your head is white, it might be because you're white or the media that you're consuming. So if you can control that narrative with a book cover or with, you know, a poster or with who you're casting, when you're showing people that story, you get them to check themselves and really, I guess, like, check their inherent bias of the way that they see the world. And I think that is that's very important, and it's also a good way to teach people a bit of a lesson, especially if they read something and assume they're white and you're like, why did you assume they were white? People go, oh shit, I wish I didn't assume that, because now I feel, and then that allows them to see things differently, not just your work but everybody else's.
Yeah, someone actually just mentioned in the Q&A that they love that I mentioned Ged Sparrowhawk from Earthsea, because the TV adaptation also cast a white actor, which Ursula Le Guin kind of came out and was like, this is whitewashing, and it's killed it. I was thinking, oh man, if this gets recorded, I'm going to get at saying, disagreeing with me that Ged Sparrowhawk was supposed to be a black character, and I can't wait to have that argument on the internet. I want to change track a little bit again. Before we jump into, like, just Q&A questions, so get them into the chat now, people, because we'll jump into there after this next one. I think personally that as artists, it's our job to push boundaries with our writing, with our creative work, but because we are also very beholden to First Nations culture and some of the things that go along with that. Is there things that you won't touch within the bounds of speculative futurism and your work? Is there a line of what you can do within futurism?
I don't like touching what I call classical Indigenous culture in futurism. I grew up in the city. I didn't grow up in the bush. Well, I grew up in the bush, but I didn't grow up in a highly cultured environment. So I don't like using kind of dream time, though there was no such thing as dream time. I don't like using those sort of stories or any of those things, because for the most part, it's very hard to avoid using something that's somebody else's. And we should never use something that's somebody else's, ever. We tell white people not to steal Aboriginal stories. We like those Aboriginal creators, know not to steal anyone else's stories either. That's not done. So to avoid doing that, I tend not to to draw from real kind of what white people call traditional culture, what I call classical culture. I avoid it like the plague because I don't think it's worth the risk.
Brooke?
Yeah, I would agree. For me, I think that there are elements of Aboriginality and elements of a pan-Aboriginal experience, not pan-Aboriginal culture, because that doesn't exist because we're all different cultures. But there's a pan-Aboriginal experience that I can pull from my version of that. And I think, like Claire said earlier, that no matter what you say, you're always speaking from your perspective, no matter how hard you try. So I'm never going to be writing from somebody else's perspective. And I think that when you speak on Aboriginal issues as an Aboriginal person, we are not a monolith. And so I speak for myself. As an Aboriginal person, my beliefs are, I think about this. And if I'm looking at including, the classical cultural elements, none of them are real. Like we have like a cultural protocol, we have cultural responsibilities, we have dreaming stories, and dreaming stories are like stories that influence us in the way we interact with the world. And that's why they're important for our culture. And all stories influence people in the way they interact with the world. They teach you a lesson whether you want to or not. And so for me, I don't want to use anything real because it doesn't belong to me. You know, my nan was a part of the stolen generation. And so we none of this, I don't own any of this, not that anybody does really own it, but I haven't earned the right to speak on in that way. And I don't think I ever will, and that's fine for me.
For me, I like with the Mugai, like Mugai is it's a real word and real thing. But me and my missus and our parents and older people, even younger people too, like, you know, we'll yarn through a lot of things. Like we'll have probably it won't just be, oh, I had an idea and then, you know, oh, that's not the nature of filmmaking anyway, but it doesn't get up on its feet for a good while until we've sort of really dissected the idea and people have had input, not just in what, like how we're representing something, but also just in the nature of the narrative, I guess, like I think sometimes we look like you're saying, Brooke, we look at stories and we see other people's tactics, and what are the tactics of the Mugai too? How does that thing try and manifest? So we don't go off half cocked, but at the same time, I agree with Claire too. Like I don't take anybody else's if that's, you know, I wouldn't presume to take anybody else's unless they somebody had a say or, you know, any of that sort of stuff. But having said that, like with the sort of speculative stuff, the more we sort of encompass, the bigger our universes are, or the bigger the story worlds are, I think the more our point of view gets out there. like it inhabits popular culture, and probably going back to what Claire was saying earlier, then it gets back to that Indigenous Aboriginal Black character having a voice and getting some sort of transformation. But I would never.
Yeah, it's about having that framework for that conversation, so that like any
absolutely kind of, yep framework.
Any moments where you are touching those cultural elements, you're doing so in a framework that you and the people around you working on that project have agreed on. Like, not to say that you're ever safe from being called out, but that's fine. Like,
no one should be safe from being called out.
Mm. No, nothing
should ever be safe from being called out.
No, and you need to be open to, like, a call out is not an attack. A call out is criticism, like, and criticism is okay. Should we do some quick fire questions and then jump into some questions from the audience? This is a bit of fun. I was talking with Brooke earlier. I was like, you know what? When white people do panels at like Comic Con, God, they get some really nice questions and no big thought curveballs. So I wanted to just like do a quick fire round where we get to have some fun. Do you have a secret vice while you work on creative things?
Tequila.
John?
Coke and Tim Tams.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm a Coke and chips person.
Chips. Nice.
So much more innocent than me.
other things I'm not going to say on camera while it's being recorded, Claire.
hero or villain, who do you prefer to write?
Villain.
You made me sound cheesy. I like heroes, but my heroes aren't cheesy, so.
And what's your favourite character or fiction, fantasy, sci-fi work that you've read or experienced?
Oh, I really like Children of Blood and Bone. It's Tomi Adeyemi, I think is her last name. And she's like created taken Nigerian cultural elements and created a young adult fantasy fiction world that is so good. I don't know if it's like so good, but for me, I love it. I love the characters. They all seem hot in my mind and like really just fun. I love those characters.
John?
I don't know if it's, I'm not as well read in the space as you guys, but probably one of my favorite characters in certainly Marvel Comics, which has always been my thing, is Dr. Doom. Because he's sort of, you know, he's a Romany gypsy lad and he's often by himself fighting impossible odds, even though he's the villain. And he always has, he has one night a year where he gets to fight the devil to get his mother's soul back. Like, he is the villain, but he's really an anti-hero, I guess. But he's just a cool dude.
Cool. Claire?
I like the, I can't remember his name, but the random plumber character in the movie Brazil. I've never seen it. He's like a guerrilla plumber who breaks into people's houses to fix their plumbing that no one else will fix. The government says, we can't fix this. And he just breaks in and fixes it. I just love that. I just love this idea of this random dude. He sneaks in like a ninja, like with his like rappelling gear to break into the window, and he breaks into the window and fixes shit and then runs away. Like a plumber spy. They're just so surreal to me. I love it.
That's so cool.
Awesome. I love that Brazil is mentioned in this. All right. So we're going to jump into some Q&A questions. If people have more, please keep putting them in. All right. We're going to start from the top, and this is anonymous attendee. And they are asking, what speculative fiction characters have been the most interesting for you? They specifically asked Claire, but I'm going to open it to everybody.
Well, like I said before, the plumber in Brazil is hilarious.
What about from your work?
Pardon?
From your work.
From my work.
Yeah.
Okay. From my work. I love, if anyone's read my work, I love Johnny Starr. The kind of random kind of cowboy outlaw in Terra Nullius. He's my favorite character. Or my other favorite character is the evil nun from Terra Nullius called Bagra, who is so, to my mind, hilariously sinister.
Cool. John, do you have a favorite character you've worked on? Or, yeah, interesting character you've worked on?
I've got a sci-fi series that we haven't got up yet. I don't know how to... that we're very close to sort of getting up. It's a thing about like it's this young boy who's kind of raised by a robot in a dystopia, and it sounds probably very, yeah, we've all seen that before, but
better.
That's right, but better. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's probably my favorite character. But that's something that we're still trying to get up. Sorry, that's not a good answer.
No, it's good. It's foreshadowing. Brooke, do you have a favorite character or a character you want to write?
I have some like anthropomorphic kind of beings that are like in one story that I am that concept that I'm working on that I am excited to sort of bring to life and like just have people hate that creature, that being. If I can make you like hate or love something, like hate, you know, like the bad guy in The Green Mile, Wild Bill, every time I see that actor in any movie, I hate him, even if he's a good character. And Dan Rockwell. And so I'm just like, oh, I hate him so much because it's just such a hateable character. So I'm very excited to create one that like people just hate vehemently, just, oh, I want to kill that person so much or that thing. So, yeah.
The best kind of characters to create is when people say, oh my God, I hate that character so much and I love that. Well, they actually love that you've made somebody that vile.
Yeah, like if I make that character have a name, if you know someone with that name, that it makes you think that they're also shit. That's what I want to get to that point.
Mason, I would love to talk about my character, but this is not about me. Mason Rothwell asks, is there an existing novel, film or canon that you would love to rewrite from a Black lens? I love this question. Thank you, Mason.
Fern Gully. I said it before. Fern Gully needs to be redone. It's already almost Black. Like the old fairy, like she's an auntie. Like 100% she's an auntie. And the main character, like she's tan. We're almost there. But I think it just has such potential for a Black story. And I think so many Black fellas have talked online on Facebook and stuff about recreating Fern Gully and just, like, people make memes about Fern Gully and use those characters and black them up, like make them into Black fellas. And yeah, I just think seeing that as a little kid, having that redone for then maybe my daughter, oh God, it would feel nice.
I already did it.
Did you?
I know, I did. The one that I most wanted to rewrite.
Oh, cool.
I did. I wanted to rewrite War of the Worlds for Black lens. And essentially, to an extent, that's what Terra Nullius is, my first novel. Because people don't know this, but War of the Worlds was actually the author trying to explain why it was that Australia was invaded so easily by the British. Trying to say it wasn't because the British are better, but they just had better guns. And he came up with the idea of War of the Worlds to explain this concept that you just have bigger guns, you win. And in a way, Terra Nullius was an attempt to retell that story. It was one of my favorite novels, and put it in a form of Black lens. And that's what I did. And the one I'd like to do that I'll never get to do, but I'd like to do it, is Lord of the Rings.
Why will you never get to do that? Let's go. Let's do it.
What? Because there's things to love about Lord of the Rings. There's the classic hero's quest, which is done quite well in that it's not the classical hero who is the hero, but there's so much fucking racism in Lord of the Rings that it's really like when I've read it in the last, I used to read it all the time, and I read it about 5 years ago, and I was just struck by how racist it was. All of a sudden, it just a switch clicked in my brain. I noticed how racist it was, and haven't been able to read it since. So I'd like to rewrite that and remove some of the stinking racism.
Please do it, Claire. Please.
Yeah, you would. I feel like you would smash it.
Black nerds around the world will be so happy.
John, do you have a?
Yeah. Red Dawn with the original, like the 80s one with Patrick Swayze, and I'm a big Patrick Swayze fan, but sort of Charlie Sheen and those guys. Like, that's, you know, it's an invasion story, and it's a sort of these kids, like Brooke's saying, that's pretty much a black story anyway, an Aboriginal narrative. To say something so baldly, like, if we, you know, even though they tried it with sort of what was it called, Tomorrow When the War Began, that sort of business, but like, if you made it, you know, if it was just a bunch of black kids from a mission who were hardcore kids, who also grew up shooting and whatnot, it really wouldn't be that much of a change for them. They might have one white kid with them who's like, gee, this is weird. Oh, is it? This is weird, getting invaded. Oh, is it? Okay.
I want to rewrite Pokemon as a black experience.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Nathan Sentence asks,
Hi, Nathan.
What's social media's role in communicating or promoting Indigenous futurism or art or First Nations voice more broadly? Bit of a change of track, but...
I don't think I'm not sure, but I would hesitate to imagine that I would be... My work could be so broadly known without social media, if I need to be honest.
Is it just about amplifying from a media perspective, or is there something within social media that we as black fellows, we are able to co-opt?
I think what it is, in my case, certainly, it's always been hard for black fellows to get published or produced. That's a fact, and it's still a fact. It's getting better now, but it's still really hard for us to get published or produced. And when we do, we don't get the same marketing or advertising budget as the white fellas do. And we don't tend to get as many reviews. And from my experience, my second book, The Old Lie, was reviewed quite extensively by the national newspapers, but Terra Nullius was basically ignored. But what built up Terra Nullius, and Terra Nullius started slow, but has kind of been steadily selling for 3 years now from a slow build, is word of mouth and social media.
Yeah.
If I'm to be completely honest, I owe a lot of my career to word of mouth on social media. So in my experience, certainly, without social media, it would not have gone anywhere near as far as it has. So I'm very grateful to it.
Brooke, John,
I think like social media, you know, as like First Nations people all over the world use social media very differently to non-Indigenous people, because we are very like, you know, having like an oral history and the way that we communicate in storytelling, it's all about community, it's all about sharing, it's all about and so like you'll see blackfellas use social media prolifically, TikTok, like Instagram, like Twitter, all of that. We're all like, and we're always pioneering those things. And I think in terms of getting a story out or even creating stories, we're a very communal people. Like we share ideas, we share concepts, and we want to see each other win, I think. Not everybody, because there's always people that are like, want to cut you down at the knees. But for me and the people I surround myself with, people are always like, here's this opportunity, here's this, can I help you with that? Like, you know, having like people that are like, I would consider famous, go, yeah, I'll read your poem that you just started working on. I don't think that necessarily happens outside of our communities, because we really want to push ourselves up. We want to push ourselves out. So Yeah, that's how I've been feeling as like an emerging writer. I'm getting a lot of people like being nice to me and holding my hand on things that I don't understand and like providing opportunities and stuff. And that's cool. I really like that. And I don't think I ever got that outside of my Aboriginal community, peer community.
I think one of the things, I'll jump to you in a sec, John. One of the things like I do with social media with Broriginals is like my brother and I play these characters. We don't play ourselves in Broriginals, like we're improvising and playing these characters. And then we like use our social media presence within that as like an extension of those characters and the worlds that we create in Broriginals. And so we use social media as like this tool to build like a sovereign land almost, like our own corner of the internet, which isn't always, it's not always a positive thing. Because then, you know, people meet us and it's like, well, you're a very different person from the Broriginal Travis. Like, yes, I am. That's a character I play.
Makes me think of Garth Nix, the children's author. He was asked in a panel I was on, how does he, we were asked if we're introverts and extroverts. He said he's an introvert. And people said, well, how do you sit up on stage and talk about your books? He said, because I'm playing an extrovert.
Yeah, I have this like thing where I'm like, yeah, every time I'm in the public domain, I'm like, I'm running on actor Travis sort of version. I was like, when I was a producer at the Opera House, I was like, this is my biggest role yet. I'm gonna be a producer. John, how do you use social media in
your? I'm not that active, but my family is, and one of the things that's good about it is that you get this instant feedback and whether something registers for people, and it registers and they love it or hate it, and the hate is just as important, like getting to hear. So it's not all just, you know, love your work. It's good when it informs you, okay, tell me why you hated it. Like, you just got to get that, you find that honest, down to earth, shoot from the hip criticism. It doesn't have to be like, you know, somebody who's really film literate or literate in space or whatever. It's just hated it because I don't like that person's face. Okay.
That was Gavin. I just hated it.
Yeah.
Awesome. I don't think we're going to get time to answer any more audience questions because I wanted to do the Gavin final thought thing.
Speaking of Gavin, yeah.
Yeah. So before we wrap up, do each of you have like a final thought, or do you want to, what have you got coming out? What, anything? Just, yeah, go. John?
I'm still working on the script for my directing debut, but feature film directing debut. But the other thing that I was talking about, the series, what I'm most excited about is where we're at. You know, you had a point in the piece that you sent about thriving versus surviving, and I'm really excited about this point where we're at, that the internet has kind of freed up. Like Claire's point, it's freed up people to find us and for us to find people. The fact that we don't have to go through the same old, because I wish I was 20 and just starting out again. It'd be so much easier. But it's a brave new world. It's a brave new world.
Claire?
I think it's NAIDOC week, and as I keep saying to people, NAIDOC week, it's like Mother's Day, when the mum spends all week, all day telling you why you need Mother's Day. I think it's, I think it's, although I think it's time that NAIDOC week comes about non-Indigenous people educating themselves about our history. And there's an easy way to do that. There's published works. There's tons of published work out there. There's films, there's books, there's all sorts of stuff. I think people should consume more media by Indigenous Australians, and that will help them kind of It'll help us assimilate them for a start, but also help them educate themselves. And as far as what I've got coming out, I've got a novel scheduled for next year, end of next year. And I've got a play I'm working on commission, which is my first play. So that's pretty intense. So I've been doing a lot of work on those things. And like all black fellas, when we kind of start getting our thing happening, we get very busy and very tired and very cranky. But I want people to go out and buy more work by Indigenous people.
Awesome. And Brooke, final thought.
Yeah, I want to echo that last bit there that Claire said as well. You know, conscious consumption of media is important. I think you should be consciously consuming everything that you do, everything that you buy, especially like as a parent. I want to see more people consciously looking at the media their children are consuming, because that will allow you to create a world where your children see things in the way that they should be seeing it, and interact with us as human beings and not as things. And also to take the opportunity to like spruik myself. I'm also, you can find me on Radio Skid Row every Friday at 12. We've got Black Fridays, thanks to Lorna Munro, and she produces all of that. So Radio Skid Row, just like, we're one of the biggest like multicultural radio stations around. Then we started out as Radio Redfern, and then we just lost all of our funding, probably because we're pretty radical. And so, you know, if you are into radical radio, you're into supporting like black radio casters and all of those other multicultural broadcasters. If you go to startsomegood.com/radioskidrow2020, you can donate to us. We have sick merch. And aside from that, I also just, I like won a cool scholarship with the Faber Academy. So I'm going to have somebody kicking my ass to actually write these novel ideas that I have. So stalk me on the internet in a nice way and see what happens, because, yeah, I got ideas.
Claire and John, did you want to tell people where they can find your work at all?
Sure. My novels, The Old Lie and Terminalius, three novels.
They're ready to go.
They're pretty much everywhere. They've been published. They're published by Hachette Australia, and you can find them on the Hachette website, or pretty much. I'm more shocked when I hear of a bookshop that doesn't have my books. And
all good bookstores, then.
All good bookstores, or online. But I prefer people buy stuff from independent bookstores, because over the last 9 months, a lot of them have gone right to the wire and have barely survived. So. Go to your local bookstore and get my two novels.
And you, John?
I don't know where to find stuff. It's out there. I don't know where.
Keep looking out for the Mugai.
Oh yeah, well, that's still the short's out there. We're doing festivals now, but the features still are good.
Absolutely. I can't wait for the Mugai. I'm so
excited.
Bit of a wrap up and final thought. I like seeing previous works that John's done, Claire's amazing work. I think like part of what you guys have done is pave the way and sort of open the floodgates for publishers to look at more and more blackfellow works. And I think like that we are about to enter the golden age of Indigenous futurism, Indigenous genre fiction, all of that cool shit that we're going to be doing. And like, I think like, you know, it's again that thing around like, we don't know what we don't know. So if I hadn't have seen you guys making that stuff for years, I wouldn't be able to do what I do now. And I'm super excited. So like, I got kind of down earlier in the year when I heard that NAIDOC theme was always will be, because I was like, well, it's not always going to be if we don't fight for it, but I think we are fighting for it. So it like, and we're presenting that vision of what it always will be. And that is so exciting. Just a quick spruik before we go. You can find my work at www.awesomeblack.org. which is the non-for-profit organization that I run for First Nations podcasting. Broriginals is on there. And Fear of a Black Planet, which is the show that I'm launching next week, will be on there very soon. And you can buy cool merch that I make and design these little Abba Digital guys. I wanted to say a huge thank you to Claire, John, and Brooke for coming on this program, because, again, fanning, and it's awesome. Thank you to Damien and Jade and Marika at the State Library of New South Wales for making this happen, because it's really great to be able to have these conversations and get this stuff out there in this way, and not just around NAIDOC Week. You guys have been a huge supporter of this work. So thank you, and we'll sign off. And thank you for the audience for joining in.
Thank you.
Thanks, man.